Hi friends! Today is going to be my wrap-up for the month of April. In the month of April, I read 7 books for a total of 2,626 pages, which is both numbers less than half of what I read in the previous month. Last month was not a great reading month for me, but we knew that was coming because I did read some slower reads that I had been planning on picking up. I also read some very short, super fun reads. So we're gonna start with the rereads and then lowest rated and to the highest rated books of the month. Let us begin with the rereads. I reread both Wind Witch and Sight Witch by Susan Dennard this month. Technically, I was only supposed to read Wind Witch and I was supposed to read Sight Witch in May, but I had a couple of days left at the end of the month and the next book that I was reading, the audiobook hadn't come through yet. And I was like, it's a novella, let's just go for it. So I was actually able to complete both of these. If you do not know, the Witchland series is a series following Safi and Izzult, who are two best friends who live in this world where people have different types of magics. Izzult is a thread witch who has the ability to see threads between people and the way that they are connected, whether they are friends, lovers, siblings, enemies, whatever the case may be. And Safi is a truth witch. And her powers are one of the most rare powers that you will see in the Witchlands. And because of this, her power allows her to either know when someone's telling her the truth or telling a lie. And with that, she is deemed to be either a valuable weapon against others or a devastating weapon against oneself. And therefore, because she is so dangerous, there are many people out searching for her and trying to either use her powers for themselves or to destroy her so that no one else can use her powers against them. The series follows the two girls basically on the run from the royals, and there's like sea battles and land battles and air battles and a lot of magic, and it's a lot of political intrigue, and I love this series. If you've been here before, you know I've reread these books a bajillion times. And I am loving this reread that we are currently doing with JD Ray Reads and just reading the series again. And I'm so excited. The next book comes out in June. Just having a great time, y'all. Then we get to my lowest rated book of the month, and that is Lore by Alexandra Bracken. I gave this a 7.25 out of 5 stars. This one hurt me a lot.
Editing Jessica here. 7.25? Excuse? This book hurt me so bad, I can't talk. I gave it a 2.75 out of 5 stars.
So this was one of my most anticipated reads for the year, which is interesting as I have never read an Alexandra Bracken book before. I do follow her on social media. I think she's great. I will pick up more of her books. I thought this was going to be the book for me, as it does have Medusa on the cover. I thought it was a Medusa retelling, and that's kind of what I had been told. And while it does have some of the characteristics of Medusa, that's not accurate. This book follows Lore, who is part of this group of people who every 7 years they have a hunt to try to find the original gods and kill them. And if you kill that god, you take their power. And it's just like this whole group of people. It's a political nightmare, which I typically love. My thing with this book is that I didn't really enjoy the plot. I don't feel like there was a lot of plot. There was a lot of info dumping, which I don't mind when it's information that I feel like I need or want to have if it's in a world that I'm really enjoying. I wasn't enjoying this world. I didn't particularly like the characters. There just wasn't much here that I loved. I considered DNFing this book quite a few times while reading it and finally was just like, just sit down and finish it. You want to know how it ends, sit down and finish it. So that is what I did. I sat down, I read through the end of it. There was a part in this book that I really, really loved where the goddess Athena was talking about the original mythos of Medusa. This is the reason why I'm obsessed with Medusa. Medusa is like the original feminist. Medusa is a woman who was this maiden priestess for Athena, and she was raped by Poseidon, and because of that, she was punished by Athena and turned into a Gorgon. She was punished by Athena for something that she had no control over, and Poseidon was not punished in any way, shape, or form. And there was a part of this book where it was discussing that aspect of it, where it was discussing, you know, how I feel about it, how I feel about her being the original feminist and her being that original person who, you know, from fairy, I don't want to say fairy tales because mythology is completely different from fairy tales, but from the mythos, from the lore that we get of these things, she is our original feminist. She predates Lilith from the Bible, which means she's the original feminist. It was talking about it and I was really excited about where it was taking it. And I was like, yes, I will stand behind this forever. And then there's a plot twist and that all fell apart. And I did not like or appreciate the direction that it went. And while it was a good plot twist, don't get me wrong, it destroyed what I was here for. There was one thing that I was holding on to this book, the one thing that I was like, okay, I can get behind this. And the plot twist destroyed that. So for me, this book was a waste of my time. I hate to say that because I think that this book definitely will work for some people. I know how much work goes into a book. I know how much work Alexandra put into this. I know how much of her soul went into this book. Again, I follow her on social media. I think she's an amazing person. But this book was a waste of my time. I think there are people out there that will enjoy this. People who like an urban fantasy story, which I do typically like, but I feel like because there was so much information on the gods, and it's information that I already know, it just, the info dumping didn't seem like, I don't mind info dumping in a story where I'm getting to learn things that I don't already know. Whereas in this, it was very confusing. The things I didn't know were not being explained to me in a way that I felt like I understood. And the things that I did know, I felt like were being over-explained. And it just didn't work for me. It did not work for me. It hurts me in ways that you will never understand. Now that I've talked about this book for 20 minutes, let's move on to something else. My next lowest rated book was The Fellowship of the Ring by J.R.R. Tolkien. This is the first book in the Lord of the Rings trilogy, which is not really a trilogy, it's one book, but that's outside of the point. Okay, I gave this a 3 out of 5 stars. Let's talk. Put your pitchforks down and let's talk, okay? I have a very detailed review on Goodreads. All of my Goodreads reviews will be linked down below if you want to know more of my full thoughts. Though on some of these, you heard me talk about them for 20 minutes already, so do you need more full thoughts? I don't know. Anyway, moving on to this guy. I respect this for what it is. I respect this for it being one of the very first commercially viable fantasy stories ever. I respect it for the beginning of a genre, for it continuing to this day allow us to write the things that we enjoy and to, you know, get to have these fantasy worlds that didn't really happen prior to this series. I respect all of that. Had I read this book when it originally came out, had I been like in my age bracket when it originally came out and had I read it, I probably would have given this a 5-star. I would have loved this book. I think had I not read anything like it before, I would have loved it. Had I read it, you know, in my teens before I started reading a lot of fantasy, probably would have given it a 4-star. Would have thought it's a little over descriptive, but it's a good book. Me at 33 in 2021, this is a 3-star book. And here's why. First, it is overly descriptive. There are a lot of things that I just don't need to know. I know that's part of the thing. I know that Tolkien's ideals are that he is a linguist first and a writer second. I get that, but I don't care. That sounds horrible. I understand, but I don't give a fuck. Okay, but really though, there's like poems and things that are completely in a language that I don't understand and I don't care about that. Like I don't, it's you're wasting my time. I know there are people that do, but I'm not one of those people. That's okay. It is overly descriptive, but I love the plot. Can we talk about the plot? Like, can we talk about the plot of this book? It's amazing. Like the actual plot of what's happening, what's going on, all of the political, societal issues, the adventure, the fantasy aspect of it. Glorious. Absolutely love it. Do not like the delivery system. Let's also talk, as we talked in lore, Medusa, original feminist. I'm a feminist. This book has 3 women in it and they're all the same woman. Arguably more than 3 women in this book, but there are 3 main women in this book. I know that we do get Eowyn later, and Eowyn is a whole other story that we will discuss when we get to Eowyn, but in this book, we predominantly have the Bombadil character, his wife, we get her, we get Arwen, and we get Galadriel. That sounds right. All three of them are described as like the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. She is so perfect. She is so wonderful. She has all this power. She does all of these things. It's the same woman three times. Now, I understand the concept that from this book series that the women that Tolkien writes are arguably a love letter to his wife. And so therefore him seeing them as these incredibly beautiful, incredibly powerful, incredibly loving women makes sense because he's basically writing them as he sees his wife. But you can't write the only three female characters you have in a book as the same character. And again, arguably more than three women in this book. But there are 11 women in this entire series. You can look up lists of characters from the series. There are 11 women in this entire series, and that includes a fucking spider. She's a spider demon. But you know what I mean? Like, there's 11 women and one of them's a fucking spider? Okay, cool. Also, if you look up the male characters in this series, because maybe there's just not a lot of characters. I don't know. Maybe there's just not. No. You look up the male characters and there are over 50 male characters. Those are just the named prominent male characters. The list is over 50. We're talking every fucking woman, including a goddamn spider, and it's at 11 women. I have a problem with that. Again, I understand it's a product of its time. It's a product of it being, you know, Tolkien spent time in the military and it was predominantly men and he was predominantly around men and women were just something kind of pushed to the side in society then and also in his life then. I get that. But I can't give this book a 5-star in 2021 as a 33-year-old woman. I can't do it. So I didn't. This is a 3-star read for me. If you don't like that, go fly a fucking kite. I don't care. Moving on. I do plan to continue reading the series. As I said, I do like the plot and I am excited to get this Sumayo in, just so you're aware. The next book we're going to talk about is Act Your Age, Eve Brown by Talia Hibbert. I gave this a 4.5 out of 5 stars. I loved this book. It was amazing. Now, out of the Brown sisters, I do think Danny is definitely still my favorite. Chloe's boyfriend is probably my favorite. Danny's probably my favorite sister's story. I still love Eve. She's great. Let's discuss. The Brown Sisters is a trilogy following these three sisters, and it involves them finding love. There are explicit sex scenes in these books. They are amazing. I love this series. Okay, they're a great, fun, fast read, and I really enjoyed them. I do think this one was a little predictable. Not gonna lie. Like, you know going in what the major problem between the two of them is gonna be, and that's okay. But it was cute, and it was fun, and it was the breath of fresh air that I needed after those two books we just talked about. Also, I had just read a book we're getting ready to talk about, and it was a fucking nightmare. It was a good book, but it was, like, fucking creepy. So this was, like, a great palate cleanser, and that is what, in my opinion, adult romance is for. It's for when you're in a reading slump, or for when you have read something really dark and you need a break. Or something super boring and you need a break. That's why I love adult romance. So, loved this. It was amazing. If you haven't picked up the Brown Sisters, you definitely should. I might do a reread later this year. Don't know. Of all three sisters, because I really enjoyed them. The next book that we're going to talk about is The Invisible Life of Addie LaRue by V.E. Schwab. I have this a 4.75 out of 5 stars. If you have been on BookTube, you know what this book is about, so I probably don't need to tell you, but it's about Addie LaRue, who essentially makes a deal with the devil to live forever, and her payment for that is that no one remembers who she is. I thought going in that I knew it was gonna hurt. Don't get me wrong, I knew this book was gonna hurt. But I thought that the ideal of, like, people couldn't remember who she was like, you know, when the sun goes down and it comes back up and then they forget who you are. No, if they walk out of the fucking room and walk back in, they don't know who she is. Like, it's that hardcore. Like, it is fucking hardcore. People literally forget her after they walk out of the door and walk back in. That threw me for a loop. This book is beautiful. It is amazing. It is wonderful. There is so much about this book that I absolutely love. Just the story of Addie. I have said recently, you know, talking about this book, if you're a fan of Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo, I feel like this is a very similar type of story. There's not a lot of plot. There's not a whole lot of things that happen, but you get to see them in so many different aspects and points of their life that you see. Evelyn Hugo only had one life technically, but she had so many different experiences throughout her life that it really felt like you were getting a multi-generational story through one woman, whereas this is very similar because Addie doesn't age, but she has lived for, I think, 400-ish years. So you get to see her throughout different periods of time. So if you enjoyed Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo, you'll probably enjoy this as well. This book was heartbreaking. It was heart-wrenching. It was so beautiful. Seeing the way that Addie was able to impact the world, even though no one could remember her, was just amazing. There's two love stories in here, and I will not say that it's a love triangle because it definitely is not. There's two major love plots in this, and I think they both do exactly what they're supposed to do. I have some questions about the logistics of one of the love interests as far as, like, would they love each other if they weren't in the predicament that they were in? But that's neither here nor there. And the end, I'm gonna call it the end game love interest. If you've read the book, you know what I'm talking about. It's hard to talk about, like, what's happening. But the guy that she ends up with at the end, I feel like she doesn't think is going to be a real thing. She's just there because she feels like that's her only option, which was kind of the case with the first one as well. But you know what I'm saying? Like, she thinks that that's her only way to make things work for her and for her life to move forward. And I disagree with her on that in the aspect of that person, whether or not they're actually able to love her, because she doesn't think they're ever going to be able to love her. And I disagree. I like the way that it ended. I would love to see a snapshot of the end of this book from, like, 100 years into the future. Like, just a little baby epilogue to let me know how things are going. So Schwab, if you're out there and you hear this and you have ideas, like, you can just send them to me via email, and I will not tell a soul what you tell me. I just want to know, like, how does it really end up in the end? This is a very slow moving, very beautiful story. It will make you cry. Yeah, it's a good book. Highly recommend. And the final book that we're going to talk about today was a 5-star read, and that is House of Hollow by Crystal Sutherland. I want you to take that 5-star with a grain of salt, because my favorite book by Crystal Sutherland is A Semi-Definitive List of Worst Nightmares, and I only gave that a 4.75 out of 5 stars. So, like, was it because I had kind of had a bad reading month and this book was just outstanding in comparison to the things that I read this month, plus, you know, DNFing 11 books or something stupid last month? I mean, possibly. But it's just how the rating system works. Part of it's that this cover is more attractive to me than the cover from the other book, but I digress. Let's move on. Okay, this book is fucking dark and creepy. Like, super creepy. It's very different from her other two books, but it definitely has that Crystal feel to it. So if you have read her other books and you weren't sure about picking this one up because people have said it's very different, I do think it is a very different type of story, but it still has that Crystal quirk to it that I really love. Definitely pick it up if you're interested. So this series follows the Hollow sisters. There are three sisters. When they were children, went missing for a month. They vanished out of thin air and then reappeared a month later, naked, and had no recollection of where they had been or what had happened to them. And you fast forward, I think it's like 12 years into the future, the older two girls are out in the real world and the youngest sister, Iris, is still in high school. So Gray and Vivi have moved on with their lives. They both dropped out of high school and went the heck out and started their lives without Iris. And when they come back into town, things, you know, always get a little bit weird, but for the most part, they're not around. Gray is the eldest sister. She is this very waifish, very ethereal type of person, and she is a supermodel, and she has her own clothing line that's just really creepy. Like, she sews things into the hems of clothing, and just, like, you find, like, weird animal bones, and it is a whole thing. And Vivi is this completely otherworldly, complete opposite end of the spectrum, is into punk rock and is a bassist in a band and just is this whole other person. And Iris is very plain. When the girls are supposed to get together, Gray doesn't show up. They go to Gray's apartment. She's not there. They can't find Gray anywhere. Gray's missing. Did she go missing the same way she went missing when they were children? And that's what leads them into this story. Them trying to figure out what happened to Gray and inadvertently trying to figure out what actually happened to them when they were children. When I tell you this book is dark and creepy, it is fucking dark and creepy. There are so many, I mean, it has, like, some gory type aspects to it, which I'm not a gore person, and this was fine for me. For instance, I read The Only Dead Indians by Stephen Graham Jones. That was too gory for me. This was fine. It's gory, but it's okay. It definitely has the horror element. It has the horror vibe. There's, like, a big bad. It's just this whole thing, and the girls are so creepy on their own. Like, just the whole story. There's major plot twists. Like, huge fucking plot twist. And the best thing about the plot twist is very early on, like, I had an inkling of what the ideal was. Like, I was like, I'm pretty sure that this is what's gonna happen. But as the book goes on, you're like, well, that's not, it's not possible. She wouldn't do that. And then it gets further and further and you're like, okay, she's not, like, that, what I thought before, that's not gonna happen, because there's really no way to make that happen with what we've learned since then. It still fucking happens, and it'll throw you for a loop when you figure out how it happens, and it's disgusting, and it's gross, and I loved it. Like, it is just so creepy, so weird, just so much about this book. Like, there's so much beauty in it, and also so much fucking grossness in it. What I will say is, Crystal does have two siblings. I think she's the eldest of the three girls, and this book is mostly from Iris's perspective, and she is the youngest of the three sisters. But you can definitely tell that Crystal has written, like, her love for her sisters into this book. You see how much those three sisters, how much they really mean to one another, how much they're willing to do for one another, what they would do for one another. There's a part of the book where Gray says she could tell you what happened, but if she told you, you'd never believe it. And I feel like that's the basis of the story. Like, I could tell you what happened, but you'd probably never believe it. These are the 7 books that I read in the month of April. Let me know in the comments below if you have read any of these, if you have any thoughts, comments, questions, or concerns. That is all I have for today. I post reading, writing, book, and planner related videos a couple of times a week. If you don't want to miss anything I have going in the future, make sure you hit the subscribe button and the notification bell down below. And until then, I will see you guys next time. Bye!